Shout out to Tears of Themis for sponsoring this video. Hello everyone! In this week's video, I'm drawing two of my viewers' original characters. It's been quite a few months since the last time I drew your OCs, so I felt like it was time for another one of these videos. I announced this a few weeks ago on all of my social media. I made sure to announce I would be doing this in advance, that way you would all have time to submit a character. And wow, there were a lot of entries! I had such a hard time choosing, it took me so long to narrow it down to picking only two people, but I finally did, so I'll be drawing my two choices in this video. But first I want to thank Tears of Themis for sponsoring this video. Tears of Themis is a free-to-play Otome adventure game developed and published by miHoYo, the creators of Genshin Impact. In Tears of Themis, you work as a new attorney at law in the city of Stellis. Alongside the four male leads, you will solve the mysteries behind the abnormal increase in the number of mental illness cases as well as incidents that threaten Stellis. To solve mysteries, you'll need to interrogate witnesses and possible suspects. My favorite part of the mystery solving process is collecting evidence from the 3D crime scenes. I find it fun looking around, finding evidence, and trying to connect all the pieces. After gathering evidence, you'll need to carefully choose the evidence you present to grant swift justice in the court trial. In Tears of Themis, every episode is a separate story, but all of the stories will finally direct to the hidden truth of the abnormality of Stellis City. Like I mentioned, you'll be solving mysteries alongside the four unique male characters. Luke and Artem are my favorites. You can interact with them and play games with them to unlock new stories and interactions. The art style and illustrations are so pretty in Tears of Themis. Since I draw and like to make art, the art in Tears of Themis is one of my favorite parts about it. I love collecting new cards and looking at the art because it's so pretty. Oh, speaking of cards, new ones have been added to the game because of the new Xmas Partyland event. The event has been launched on December 11th, so if you are watching this video the day it is released, it came out today. All of the new cards are so pretty, but they're not only new cards, you can also explore the fair alongside the male leads and enjoy winter festival activities. This time around, there is even a hidden map that offers more themed random events. I'm excited to take part in this new event, and if you want to try out Tears of Themis for yourself, there's a link in the description. To stay up to date on Tears of Themis announcements, you can follow the official accounts on any of these sites. Thank you so much again to Tears of Themis for sponsoring this video. Okay, now let's get drawing. So the first character I am drawing was created by Yuna. Their OC's name is Kea. She's one of the six goddesses of the ocean. She is the source of vitality of the corals. Her koi are special saltwater koi that were created by another goddess for Kea because she loves koi so much. So we are starting with my cleanup sketch. Recently in my videos, I show the rough sketch process, but I already feel like this video is going to be on the longer side, so we are skipping that and going straight into cleanup. I chose Kea for a few different reasons. The first being, I really liked her design and I think it's really pretty. Plus, I really like the color scheme. Secondly, I really wanted to draw the koi fish. I thought it sounded fun to draw the koi. I really like pictures that include fish and I think they look really cool, so I wanted to try it for myself. Plus, I love koi. I think they are so pretty. For Kea's pose, I decided to have it turned into a three-quarter view and we are kind of looking up at her. I decided to have her hands placed around the pearl orb thing. You won't see it in the footage, but I really struggled with deciding on a pose for Kea. I knew I wanted to have her hands around the orb, but I couldn't decide on how to place them. At first I had her in front view, and that just wasn't working. So now she's in this view, and this view worked a bit better. Like I mentioned, there were a ton of OC entries for this video. I had such a hard time choosing. There were so many amazing characters that I wanted to draw. I was about to just randomly pick like I do sometimes, but for some reason I wanted to pick some characters myself that inspired me in some kind of way, or there was an element about the character that I really wanted to draw. Like I mentioned, in this case I really liked the underwater concept and the inclusion of the koi. So this cleanup sketch is actually going to be my line art, kind of. You see, for some reason I was in a digital painting mood, so I decided instead of using my usual process, I would change it up and do some digital painting. So in case you don't know the difference between my usual process and my digital painting process, basically, My usual process is more like a coloring book. I draw the illustration of line art and then fill in with the colors and all that stuff. Whereas for a digital painting, I have my sketch, then I fill it in with colors underneath, and then I merge my layers and paint over the sketch. And it results in a picture that feels a little bit more painted, if that makes sense. So now I have the colors filled in, and at first I had the ocean be really dark. I was thinking about having the orb glow and cast a light onto things, but I felt like that maybe would be a little too complicated, and I wasn't sure if I was up for that. So I scrapped that idea and made the water lighter. I started to get the shadows in place, and at this time my layers were all still separate. I thought maybe it'd be nice to get the basic shadows in place before merging things, but I don't know, things were feeling too stiff and not very fluid, so I decided to merge all my layers. My digital painting process kinda only works for me if I just jump into it, but don't worry, I always save a backup of my sketch just in case I mess things up or need it. After merging things, I felt like I wanted to focus on the hair. The hair is kind of flowing all over the place and it makes up a good portion of the picture, so I felt like I would be getting quite a lot done if I got that cleaned up. But I end up working on the face in just a moment. I'm kind of chaotic when I do digital painting and I tend to jump from one thing to another, which makes recording voiceover and explaining my process kind of tricky because I'm always jumping from one thing to another thing to another. I've kind of talked about this in the past, but my usual drawing process is a bit more systematic. I work on one part at a time, I add shadows to it, and then add the highlights, and move on to the next step of the coloring. But for digital painting, I'm doing a lot more color selecting, blending, reworking shapes, and jumping from one spot to another, and it just feels a bit more all over the place. I always feel like I have a harder time feeling confident when digital painting because the artwork isn't as finished and it does a lot of changing from the start to the finish of the picture. Because you're doing a lot of tweaking as you paint compared to my normal process where I don't do much tweaking once I get the line art in place. But this is kind of the nice part about digital painting. Things aren't very set in stone and there's a lot of room to tweak things. Like for the hair, I would change the width of the strands and kind of change how they flow and where they're placed. But for my usual process, doing stuff like that would be very troublesome because I would have to change the line art and the coloring, and it'd be a lot of work. So there is something very freeing about digital painting because you can so easily kind of change things up. The hands were one of the parts I was having a hard time cleaning up and making them look how I want them to. I actually decided to give her fingernails just because I felt like her hands needed them, and I felt like they would make her hands feel more mature and more elongated and kind of mystical, if that makes sense. The power of adding fingernails. I don't always give them to my characters, but sometimes I do if I feel like they're needed. And I am glad I added them in this case. I felt like they helped the hands a lot. I really liked adding the see-through shoulder bits on her outfit. I did add those on a new layer because I needed to turn down the opacity to make them see-through. It was also fun adding the blue scales. On the upper portion, I tried to use a variety of blues to give the scales texture. Oh, and here I'm cleaning up the koi. I'm not super confident when it comes to drawing animals, so I kept them more stylistic and simple. You don't really get to see it later because I'm really zoomed out, but I used slightly different colors to add a scale texture to the koi. So for her eyes, I wasn't totally pleased with how they were looking at the moment, so I decided to just completely paint over them, and I thought this would make things easier if I used multiple layers because then I could make the eyelashes and the white part of the eye and the iris. The eyes are a really important part to me, so I wanted to put a little bit more work into them to try to make them look nice. One of the things I was really struggling with was her iris placement. She's kind of looking down at the orb that's in front of her, and I didn't want her to look cross-eyed, so I was trying my best to place irises in a way that looks like she's looking at the orb, but she's not going cross-eyed. I hope it doesn't look like she's going cross-eyed. So things were coming together, and I was starting to add the finishing special effects like the backlight and the rays of light. And I thought maybe this would make things kind of pop, but things were still feeling really dull to me and kind of boring. So remember that glowing orb idea I scrapped earlier? Well, I decided to bring that back and I thought I would give it a shot, and if I didn't like it, I would act like it never happened. So I apply a dark violet to the character, set it to multiply and lower the opacity. Over that, I use a layer set to add glow and apply a yellow glow to the orb. I wanted the glow to be kind of soft and not super harsh, so there will be lighting on the face, but it won't be like super powerful. Because the yellow light is coming from below, her face is going to get hit on the under planes of her face, or planes that are facing downwards, if that makes sense. So the light will hit areas like the underside of her nose, under her eyebrows, and her upper lip. I was kind of nervous when applying the lighting. I don't shade faces that are lit from below very often, so it's a lighting situation I'm not as familiar with. But thankfully, I feel like it went pretty smoothly, and it definitely gives a very different feeling to the picture, and I think it gives the illustration that pop of interesting I was hoping for. And here's the finished picture. I hope you like it, Yuna. Thank you so much for letting me draw your character, Kaya. I had a lot of fun working on this illustration and drawing her. Now let's see who I'm drawing next. This character was created by Rainchi. Their character's name is Shiro, and they are an ice dragon that wields a bow and arrow. So let's start drawing Shiro. My idea for Shiro is that I have her standing with her bow and arrow in a forest, and there are icicles around her. The reason I chose Shiro is because I thought it sounded cool to draw a character with a bow and arrow. Plus, it sounded really neat to render icicles. I've never done that before, so I wanted to give it a try. As you can see, I have my reference on the left, and can I just say I spent ages trying to find a reference? Mostly because I didn't know what I wanted. I didn't know if I wanted something more dynamic, if I wanted Shiro to be aiming the bow or just standing with it. I couldn't make up my mind. Then I saw this pose and I really liked it. She's interacting with the bow, but it's not like she's totally ready to shoot something. I really wanted a reference for the holding of the bow because I wanted it to be fairly accurate. My brothers have a lot of bow and arrows, so I have held them before and tried shooting them. I'm not very good. So that did help me a little, but I still wanted to have something to look at to help me out a bit more. To add some movement to the picture, I decided to have the wind blow through Shiro's hair. She has very long hair, so I thought I should use it to my advantage to add some movement to the still scene. Drawing the bow was kind of tricky. Thankfully, Shiro's bow isn't super detailed, but it was still tricky to make everything line up and put into place. I need to have the bow be in her hand and the string go through the other hand, and also have the arrow line up correctly with both hands while still being in the middle of the bow, and it was kind of a lot to think about. After a bit, I did get a sketch in place, but to make sure the bow wasn't wonky, I used a symmetrical ruler over my sketch to draw a more symmetrical bow and arrow. Now we are on to the line art. I won't show you the full process, but I'll show you some slow clips just because I find them satisfying, and maybe some of you do too. So we are getting closer and closer to Christmas. My family is basically done decorating, and my mom and I have been wrapping presents. Because there are now presents under the tree, my little brother Jack has been getting pretty excited for Christmas, and it's really cute. He's 4 years old now, and for other years he didn't totally understand Christmas because he was so little and stuff. But this year he really gets Christmas and understands it all, and so he's getting really excited. He was asking if he could open his presents early, and it was so cute. We had to explain to him that it wasn't Christmas yet, and that we had to wait for Christmas to open the presents. Okay, so now we are on to coloring and getting the background in place. For the foreground, I was going to have bushes, but then I was like, wait, it's winter and there are no leafy bushes. What do I do? I tend to put like bushes or things in the foreground, but then that felt like it wasn't an option. So I Googled winter bushes, and it seems like snow can kind of form on top of the branchy bushes. So I went with that. I was worried I wouldn't have anything to place in the foreground. Next, I'm adding the branch in the foreground that the icicles will be on, as well as the trees in the background. For these, I'm using a pen with a bumpy texture just because I don't want the trees to feel super smooth. I want them to feel a bit rough. So yeah, I'm just drawing a bunch of different tree shapes. I make the trees get lighter and lighter to make them kind of fade into the distance. Now that the background is more in place, I'll start shading Shiro. The lighting that Shiro is in is very white light, because I imagine it's maybe an overcast kind of day, and she's surrounded by snow that is bouncing light all around. So we're not going to get any super intense shadows or highlights of different colors. However, Shiro's clothes are pretty dark, so the shadows on those are going to get really dark. It was a lot of fun to draw and shade her hoodie. I have it slouching down off of one of her shoulders, and this makes the hoodie bunch up a lot, so that was a lot of fun to render. To add the shadows, I add a shadow where I want it to be with the pen tool, and then blend it out with the blending tool to give it a slightly softer edge and make the shadow look more interesting and less flat. I'll sometimes drag my pen into the shadow to bring in some of the base colors into the shadow and give it a kind of bounce-like look, if that makes sense. After the shadows, I go in with the highlights. I find with black or dark colors, I often have to go in with a good amount of lighter color to help give it form and not look flat. With lighter colors, I can mostly just use shading and I can make it look like it has a lot of form. But with darker colors, you can only go so dark with the shadows, so I have to use some lighter colors. I go in with some really bright highlights so I can see where I'm putting them and then later lower the opacity. When I look at other people's art recently, I really like when people remember to have different elements of the character cast a shadow onto another part, and this is something I often forget about. So this time I wanted to try to keep that in mind, and I decided to draw a shadow for where her hand and the bow and arrow are. I basically just draw a kind of rough silhouette of what I thought these things would look like when casted onto the skirt. It's a pretty simple detail to add to the picture, but I feel like it does really help give the feeling that she's holding the bow out. Next is Shiro's hair. Her hair fades from a white to a light purple. I feel like I don't have anything super exciting to say for her hair. I kind of just colored it. It was a pretty standard process, which was nice. Sometimes shading hair can give me issues, especially if I can't really decide on a hair shading style I want to go with. One thing I did do kind of different is because Shiro does have light hair, I don't go in with much for highlights. Instead, I use more shadows to add shape and form to the hair. A lot of times I suggest how the hair is flowing with highlights, but because her hair is so light, I have to use shadows in this case. Shiro's eyes are very interesting. They are a very pale yellow, and the shadows are a purple color. The original picture doesn't have pupils in the irises, but I often like to indicate some kind of pupil, so I used a light purple to add the pupils to the irises. One part I thought was really neat is the blue highlights in the original picture. I think they are a fun pop of color, so I definitely wanted to include those. Next, I'm adding the icicles to the horns. The icicles are very small, so I'm not going to render them a ton like I will with the other icicles in the foreground later on. I just went in with some white icicle shapes and then added some purple to the middle of them. I do wish I could have maybe rendered them a bit more, but yeah, like I mentioned, they are so tiny. But now it's time for the big icicles. I was really anticipating this part because I was super excited to render the ice, and I was a bit nervous. I wasn't sure if I'd be able to do it, but I'd give it my best shot. So usually when I think of ice, I think of white and see-through. However, when I was looking at my reference picture, it actually includes a lot of dark colors, especially around the edges. So I took a dark color and then encased the branch with that color and drew the silhouette of the icicles. After getting the dark shape in place, I start erasing the inside parts. I make there be a small fade between the color and the branch. This helps give the idea that the ice is going around the branch and that there is a bit of space between the ice and the branch. I then start erasing the middle portion of each icicle. I wanted the icicles to look like they had a bit of form and shape to them, so I erase the color in kind of sections, and wherever I feel like a new kind of section is starting, I leave some of the darker color. Having a reference for the icicles was super helpful, but I was also experimenting and trying to think of how I can convey these colors and shapes as ice. And one of the parts that really helps do that is adding the highlights. This is where I get a bit more stylistic. My reference did have highlights, but not like a ton. I felt like I needed to push things a bit more and add more highlights to the ice because this will be helping the icicles look really icy. My reference picture had a bunch of little air bubbles in the ice, so I used a bubble brush and added some tiny bubbles inside the ice. I feel like the bubbles are a really cute little detail. I never really noticed how icicles have bubbles in them. I had a lot of fun rendering the ice, and it kind of tricked my sister for a moment. She thought I edited in some real icicles, so I feel like maybe I succeeded in drawing the ice. Lastly, we have the finishing process. This is the part where I basically just slap a bunch of gradients on everything and try to make things feel more cohesive with filters and all that stuff. And here's the finished picture of Shiro. This illustration was a lot of fun to work on, and I loved getting to work on the ice. I hope you like it, Rainchi. And thank you all so much again to all of you who submitted your characters. I really loved getting to see all of them. Before we end, I want to thank my super amazing patrons for supporting my work. It means so much to me. And thank you for watching this video. I hope you enjoyed it, and I'll see you all next week in my next video. Bye!